I would like to introduce Meneer Kroon, and I think all of you would like to say something to Meneer Kroon. On three.
Especially in Nazi Germany, on the the boss. Who was the boss in Germany? In Germany?
Hitler.
Hitler! This is a smart boy, not smart. These kids are smart here. Adolf Hitler was the boss, and he didn't like Jews. Yes?
I know why, because he thought and why? They were weak.
That's right. Say it out loud.
Hitler didn't like Jews because he thought they were weak.
And Hitler was a man.
I'm leaving because everybody knows that. You know the typewriter? Yeah. That's right. At least you know something. And put a typewriter, and then you took it downstairs, and you put it in the machine, and you turn it with your hand, and I made 20 copies. And that's where I went wrong. Because one of the guys who didn't like me at all, and he was also Jewish, because there are some Jews that don't like each other either, you know. We're all just regular people. You cannot like everybody. And he took that poster and posted it on a tree. And before you know, and my name is on it, because I was very proud that I did it. It was not a piece of art like what I saw here, but I agree. You guys are artists. A lot of very good stuff that I saw. And before you know, I got real scared, and I went home early, and they were waiting for me, and they arrested me. And my parents, all three of us. And we were put in a little prison, in the waiting room of prison. And by the way, I forgot to tell you, I had a false name. And it tells you that I was not a Jew, but a Christian, that I was a star to go to the Jewish school. And that economy, that's so they knew in 5 minutes that I was Yaakov and not Cornelius Rosenbaum. It gave me a long name, Cornelius Rosenbaum. And I was arrested. And but I thought that my parents were arrested too. And I tell you that at the end of my story this morning. So I was in a little prison in the city of Utrecht. It's in the center of Holland. And I was there maybe, you know, time didn't mean anything. I was supposed to maybe 2 or 3 months. And then finally I was sent to a concentration camp in Holland called Westerbork. And there, but there's not a regular concentration camp because we didn't have to work. We just sat there and waited and waited until every Friday a train truck came to pick up the Jews and send them to a concentration camp in Poland. You know that country, Poland? Yeah. And what's the name of the concentration camp?
Auschwitz.
And then we went in that train. Now the train, I have to explain, it took 3.5 days to get there. And it was not a Pullman with beautiful velour seats and served coffee and tea. No, it was a freight. 150 people, men, women, and children, standing up for 2.5 it was not even room to sit down. And the toilet was a bucket in the corner. And it took all that time to get to Auschwitz. And in Auschwitz, there was a welcoming committee. Our transport, I found all these things out after the war, that transport was 3,500 people, all from Holland. And when you arrive in a concentration camp, the welcoming committee is not there with flowers. No. No, not that way. The head of this committee was a man called Dr. Joseph Mengele. But you know, a doctor is there to heal you, right? If you're sick, you go to the doctor to get well again. And we need to a doctor, right? Have you been to the doctor? Yeah, but what was your illness? You had the flu, and you got 2 pills. No? Wrong. Okay. Well, I'm wrong sometimes. Don't giggle. I'm wrong sometimes too. Dr. Mengele did the following. Men on one side, women and children on the other side. And the finger. You, left. You, right. And he looked at you if you were healthy. Mainly male went to the his left side, and the female and the children on the other side. And then we had to march to the actual camp from the platform, but not a railroad station, because there's a tower and a platform, and we had to walk to Auschwitz. At the arrival in Auschwitz, that was the moment that you really lost what?
Your freedom.
Your freedom and also your name. The guards there, no, nice. The guards there didn't say, hey, God, come here a moment. No, no, they said, hey, Jew, hey, 26, 23, come here. And what do you think they did to make sure that you would never forget that number? They tattooed it on my arm. Now, you know, today tattoos are very, very fashionable. Everybody knows. So I'm very fashionable. You see this? 826. He wants to film my arm. Can you get a close up? And that was me. So not only did I lose my freedom, I lost my name also. And we had to work very hard in that camp. I was a digger. There was a sewage system was built around the officers' barracks. The officers, Nazis. And we had to dig the ditches, and then the company came from Germany, Commander Peterson, and they put all these pipes in for the sewerage system. And one day, one of the guards called me, hey, Jew, 826, 23, come here. And I wanted to walk around. He said, no, jump. And I jumped, and guess what? I was a gymnast, but not so good anymore, because there was not much food in Auschwitz. A little soup, and a little tea, and a piece of bread on Thursday, and that was it. So I jumped and I got in the middle of that ditch and hurt my leg very much, very bad. And I didn't have to work anymore, and they put me on the cart with the soup that you brought out of the camp, of friction camp, and then to the workplace outside the camp, the barracks of the Nazis. And I went to what they called the Krankenbau, the hospital. Now, hospital is the same as a doctor. You are sent to the hospital to get better. They sent you to the hospital to get well. That was not that way in Auschwitz. Every week there was what they called selection. And they selected the people that were really sick and would never get well, and they were sent outside, and we had never heard from them again. So what do you think they did with these people that didn't look strong? Yeah. What they did with the people if they couldn't work anymore?
They probably killed them.
Killed them. And how did they kill them?
Well, they would either use the gas chambers, yeah, or they would use their guns.
That's right, shoot them or in the gas chamber.
In the movie, it said that all the really strong men would die because they could fight the Germans.
That's right, Ted. It's very smart. It's something that I forgot to tell you. If there was a guy like this coming to the camp, they didn't like him either, because there was a possibility that in his anger he would jump one of the guards. And they sent him also to the gas chamber. One day, instead of, they screamed always, selection, and if they all sit up in bed. But this time they showed, Achtung, Aufstehen bitte. Attention, get out of your beds. And then we had to get out of bed and stand in front of our bed. Now you know, these beds were not like in your home, you know, it was mattresses and pillows and blankets. But now there was a plank with a piece of mattress, so-called mattress. It was a burlap bag with straw in it. And three on top of each other. It was three, like you have in some people, they have it in a home for their two children. It's that market. And it was not anything else. It was not control or anything. It was selection. And Mr. Mengele, Dr. Mengele, went through the hospital, through the Krankenbau, and picked, and there were 28. We had to get up. marched out across the street, and across the street was another barrack, and to the second floor, and his helper, Dr. Kashuk, Dr. Emil Kashuk, opened the door, and he walked in, and he was stunned. Not the bunk beds, three on top of each other, regular beds and regular mattresses, and a little nightstand next to it. We were flabbergasted. But in Auschwitz, you had to be very careful. If there was something that was a little bit different than the rest, then there was something going on. And in here is what's going on. You know, in this country, we have a little protection, and the research professors cannot do that in this country. They cannot take human beings for their tests, because sometimes they don't survive these tests. So they do it with animals. Like this is better. In my opinion, it's almost the same. I don't like that. I think that you find out something to do it in the laboratories with the same outcome. And here is what he did. He injected us with sulfuric acid. Does anybody know what that is? And with the sulfuric acid, there were cancer cells mixed. All after the war we found that out. And if you go to your computer and you type in Dr. Mayer, then it tells you the story of what he did to us. And he injected it in our upper arms. And I don't know if you can see that from a distance. It's hard to see. But first it's flat. You see how flat it is? Instead of round, because the whole piece missing. It was a tumor that grew in 2-3 weeks, it was this big. And then Dr. Mengele didn't come back. He sent his friend, Dr. Emil Kashuk, and they cut all these tumors out of our arms. And they didn't stitch it, they clamped it. And that was in 1944, and the clamp didn't come out until 1946. Almost a year after the war, because it grew in that year under our skin, and it was another operation. That's why these little scars are big, nasty looking things. I have never heard anything from all these people that walked out with Dr. Emil and never came back to our room, so you can imagine what they did with it. And left with three. Three guys, two from Holland, Simon Jacobs, and me, Jaap Rohler, and a Hungarian boy, Barry Thomas. Funny thing, Barry Thomas. Barry, in Hungary, they mentioned it. The last name first, and the other name, so the first name last. So it was really Thomas Barry, but he was Barry Thomas. So we had three left, and we thought, now, we send them back in the camp, that's better than here, because they might kill us at the end too. Well, something happened. It was in January, and it was cold, it was ice, and we heard a rumor that the Russians, the Russian army, who was fighting the Nazis, was getting closer and closer to Auschwitz. And we said, that's great, we got to be liberated. And then we heard, if you don't stay, then you're luckier than staying, because if you stay, they shoot the Russians, they will shoot you. And if we go, then we had to go on a transport. And we thought, again, in the freight cars. Have you ever heard of that word, the death march? You have read it in your books, right? I see a lot of shaking yes. That was us. He left us about 25,000 people. And we marched, not all the way, but for days and days and days. And they fell by the side, couldn't walk anymore. You know, they didn't get good food, and we didn't get anything to drink. And we couldn't eat the snow because there was oil and all kinds of chemicals in there, and you would die that way. So we marched and marched and marched, and we came to a little town called Brünn, where we were loaded in a train. Yeah, freight cars, but not with doors and a ceiling. Open cars. And for a day, it was about, again, guessing, we were after the war in the stories, anywhere between 20 degrees and 30 degrees below zero. And a lot of our men died in the very place where we had to push them out from the side because, you know, after a day or so, it's not very nice to be with the body. And we marched and trained. We went to Mauthausen. Now, Mauthausen was not as big at that time as Auschwitz. But there was one thing that was just horrible. We worked in the Stein room, and that are the quarries, the stone quarries. Now, we have them here in Georgia. Have you ever made a trip to the stone quarries here in Georgia? Well, you have to go there all the time. It's a tremendous terrain, and they dig the stones out in the ground, and they go deeper and deeper and deeper, and it goes as deep as up to the ceiling here. Not in Mauthausen. In Mauthausen, the quarries were up 1,800 feet and had two terraces where we had to pick the stone and throw it over. The gas chambers, because the camp was smaller, the gas chambers were not as big as those in Auschwitz. Another way to get rid of some people, if there was a big transport coming in and there was no room for them, then in the morning, when we marched to the quarries, the leader had to say how many prisoners he had. Like, he asked, how many prisoners? And he said, 74. Come back with 40. So we knew some of them were pushed over, because that's the way they did it. So every day we worked with that fear. One day, we arrived with our group that worked on the second terrace, was about 1,400 up. We arrived at the camp, at the gate, and you, not Mengele, just the camp coming down, and he picked out a number of people, and we were put in a train, and this time it was a real train, you know, with seats and the whole works, and no coffee or tea, but only seats. And we drove for a little while, and all of a sudden the train stopped, and we saw a sign, Ebensee, E-B-E-N-S-E-E, Ebensee. Now, it's the lake. Zee, in German, is lake, in English. And this was Ebensee, was a very nice resort. Now, ours was not exactly the resort. No. If you go to the computer and type that one word in, if you have a pencil, I spell it again for you. E-B-E-N-S-E-E. I'll wait till you find a pencil. You got a pencil? So do it tonight. A bends A, and then you put two letters in caps at the end. You know, you go to Google and you Google it. K said, it means cut said, and it is concentration camp. The first line to describe the camp is the following. Agency is the most diabolic camp of all camps. You know what it means? It's the worst one of them all. And then you read what happened there. And you see the pictures. You have to go back in history. There was a man working here after the war who really helped build our space system. His name was Werner von Braun. Remember that name? Von Braun. He was then a Nazi, and he built the V2. Anybody knows what the V2 was? The V2 was a bomb, a project that a long, 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 going up in the air with an engine loaded with explosives. The engine was a time clock. And the time clock, the moment it came over England and over London, when the men were working as soldiers, and the women and children at home were killed with the V2 because over London, the time clock stopped and the thing went down in big, big, solid, a lot of people in the neighborhoods in London. And if you see some pictures what that looked like when the war was over, it was just horrible. And that was Werner von Braun. And what we had to do is, the English bombed Peenemünde, that is in Germany, where that bomb originally was made in a factory. And we had to build that factory in Ebensee. Now I told you it's a big lake, and it was not much land, it was a mountain. Not very high, maybe 1,500, 2,000 feet. And we built long street level. Inside, we drilled these big hallways, pneumatic drills, 125 pounds in the morning, 6 o'clock on your shoulder. Then, during the night, they did the explosive of the holes that we drilled the day before, so the dust was flying everywhere, and there was no system like air conditioner or an exhaust to get all that dust out, so we worked in dust and to our knees in water. Now, by that time, it was 3 years later, because I had to take a shortcut, because, you know, after an hour, you have to go back to class. You like that better than here? No. You don't have to. But I hope you do. So we built these factories inside that mountain and most of it under the ground. After all these years with bad food, just a little soup, we didn't know what it was. It was not like your mother's chicken soup or bean soup. It was kind of a funny color and a stuff in that we couldn't identify, that we ate it because it was the only thing we had. When I entered the camp, my weight was 110 pounds, and at that time, because I was liberated in that camp by the American Army, at that time my weight was 69 pounds. I was skin and bones. I had to pick the thing up, and on my shoulder, and I couldn't do it anymore. I fell, and I was carried out and back in the camp, and was put in a barrack, what we call block. It was called the Asocialen block, asocial block. And then by the people asocial, we were not regular guys anymore. We were not worth a darn thing. We got half rations and sometimes no rations. So we didn't get to eat, so my 69 pounds became 68, and then on a good day, it came back a little bit. But at liberation, my weight was 69 pounds, so my liberation papers for the American Army, you can see that number 69 pounds. So I was put in a block, no food, no nothing, and I was just unbelievable. It's hard to believe that I even could. I had those only bones. When I was liberated and sent back to Hobbit, I could not sit. I could only lie because there was nothing there. It was just bone that skin was hanging down. It was not a very beautiful sight. I see the ladies there, all the faces here. I look a little bit better because in those years, I was fighting to get way back. Now I'm fighting to lose it again. Anyway, so there was a watchtower, and every day there was a Nazi officer standing there with a machine gun, making sure that nobody escaped. Like get out of, I couldn't get out of bed. You know, there was no way. Nothing. One day I woke up in the morning, and there was a watchtower, and there was a civilian in a regular suit, and no machine gun. And at the same time, I heard a tremendous, tremendous noise. And that noise came from the tanks who entered the camp. They just ran through the gates and through the walls, and there they were, and that was liberation. I cannot tell you what we felt. I mean, I cannot describe that, but it's still a problem, because through the years, I had no idea, first, what happened to my parents, and second, you know, my grandparents, my uncles and aunts, and my 27 cousins. So they sent me to a hospital in the city of Linz that is only about 25 kilometers. You know what a kilometer is? There's that measure that is what we use in Europe, and that we tried in this county, but we love the inches. So do I. I was sent to Linz. Now, Hitler was born 18 kilometers outside Linz. I didn't know that he was dead at that time. I was hoping he was in prison, but then after the war we found out that he killed himself in the bunker that he lived in for about a year. And that was wonderful. I mean, we gave a party. Yeah, it deserved a party. It's not very nice that we did, but not so nice either. So finally, from Linz, I was flown back to Holland, to the city of Breda, and that's where I found out something that was wonderful and not so wonderful at the same time. First, my parents were still alive. When I was arrested, there was a lady who worked with the underground. She picked up my parents and sent them to a little town, Grootouders, in the middle of Holland, and they were inside for all the time, or a little bit over 3 years, never came outside. And they were still alive, so they put me on a jeep, on an open jeep, with a stretcher on the side. Have you ever seen that? Stretcher on the side, and there were two ex-prisoners, and they drove us to our hometown. And that's where I found, in Amsterdam, I found my parents. But the ugly thing that I found out, that none of my other family, my three grandparents, all my aunts and uncles, and all my 27 cousins that I played with and fought with, were all different camps. Later, there was a book that you could read exactly where they were killed. And most of them were put in outfits in the gas chambers, like you read, and that was a very pleasant ending, that I was still alive, very sick, took a year to get over my tuberculosis. And in 1957, I picked up my family, and if you turn around the head, you see the man with the beard and with the camera. This is my son, who was then 7 years old, and now he's 30, you can see that. Oh no, he doesn't want to come. Anyway, that is really the end of my story. Are there any questions? I heard that you have seen the movie, The Boy in the Pajamas, in the striped pajamas, and you have read the book of, who's the young lady? Anne Frank. Now to tell you a little story on the side. I told you about the young lady from our gymnastic club, and we became friends all these years, and she was also sent to a concentration camp, and her parents were killed, and she survived. She came to Amsterdam, and my mother said, and my father, they had a discussion about it. And they said, listen, they always thought that you were a brother and sister, so that's made it official, and she became my sister. She came from Germany and moved to Amsterdam on a square called Merwedeplein, number 6. Next door lived Anne Frank on the second. In the middle of the square, and it still is there, there's now a statue, a beautiful one of Anne Frank, the way she looked when she was arrested. And also killed in the camps. We played a game on that square, called Merwede Square. We played a game, honkbal. Anybody ever heard of honkbal? I'll translate it for you. The rules are a little bit different, but it's very close. Baseball. And we had a club. And, you know, I didn't live even in the same neighborhood, but Albert was there because of Laura, that was her name, Laura Byler. She was there, and she, before she became really my sister, she had an apartment there. And again, it was in the building where she lived all the years with her parents, next to Anne Frank. And we played baseball before the war on that square. And, now, Anne Frank didn't fall there. She was was a big, tiny little girl. And she was sitting on the second floor, number 8, watching us playing honkball. About the same, the bed is a little bit different, it's a flat bed, because the round bed is too complicated. That would work for that people. So a flat bed, and the little bases were a little closer together. And then a sister, and you know the name of her sister? What was her name? I heard it whispering, Margot. Now Margot was my age. She entered as a little guy. And you know, three boys, we don't play the little girls. Absolutely not. So I played honkball with Margot Frank, who was also killed in Berry, Belgium. Another kid. So after the war, there was an organization from Israel that was called Hashirah. Hashirah. It's a Hebrew word, and I'm dumb. I can never remember what it meant, but I tell you what it did. They took boys and girls when they were 15 and 16 years old, and they trained them to go to Israel. And I said, why don't they just get in the plane or on the boat and go to Israel? Because Israel needed farms, and Holland was famous for the farms. We had cows, we had land where we grew wheat and many other things. And that was ideal, the club called Hashirah. And when they got, after the training of 18 months, they were sent to Israel and they were going and became farmers in what? Who got the names of the names in the kibbutz? Kibbutz. And that is really the end of my story. So you see everything, there is always something that was ugly and something good came out. Now, let me first say how the good comes out. The good comes out, you cannot learn. That has to be inside you. And then you must overlook all the nasty things in the world, and you hope that you can do something to make this world better than it is. Not that it is, be overcome. We have been in many troubles through the years, hunger, floods. You know, Holland is sea level, and we lived always and there were dikes to protect us. But in 1950 it broke, and a lot of people got killed by the water. Now the other thing. There is one word, it's always one word. There is one word that covers it all, and that word is sanctioning. Do you know what it means? Yeah. Oh, you're not a child. I heard that they were young and a little bit older, but
compared to you, yeah.
You're my age. So yeah, we
in dog years.
So here, sanctioning. What does it mean? It
means to suppress. To suppress.
No, it's the other way around. It is not to suppress, but
to allow.
To allow. And that is the biggest danger in the world. Let me tell you about Hitler. How did Hitler have this idea to kill how many Jews?
All of them.
6 million. 6 million. And you think that's it? Oh no. They were after Christians also. If you were a Christian minister and you climbed on your pulpit and tell the people that the Nazis should be killed, not the Jews and not the Christians, then they also went sent to Mauthausen, Ebensee, and Auschwitz. And they were killed the same way. And that number is close to 2 million. And then the unknown, that is people that were just killed for no reason. That's what they did in Holland, that's what they did in Germany, that's what they did in Poland, that's what they did in Austria, and that's what they did wherever they were in charge of, and then what did they do? They sanctioned it to kill these people. So nice people that wanted to survive because they thought that Hitler was coming in, they became ugly people. And they became the people, the guards in the concentration camps, and the doctors that instead of healing killed the people. That's sanctioned. So there are three words that you have to keep in your mind. You. Yeah, what are the three words that I mentioned? The last one was sanctioning, and the one before. Who remembers?
Freedom.
There's number one. I'm not going to say it. I'm going to think about it, and tomorrow you tell the teacher. It's a good lesson. Think about it tonight. I'm not going to tell you. So I thank you for a good audience and to behave so nicely. And I thank the teachers and the management and the, what we call, principal. And the principal, I thank them for letting me do this. Because you know there's a tremendous responsibility involved. Because I put something in your mind that might be good for one person and not so good for the other. I hope I did it in a way that all of you will spread what?
Freedom.
Okay, say it after me.
Freedom.
Thank you.
What did you say thanking him for him giving us his time and sharing this with us? Thank you, Meneer Kroon.
You're pretty bijzonder kinder.
You're special children.
Oh, very special. Because, can I ask the teachers if you're esquired during my speaking, esquired in the classroom? Oh, they say no already, so that is already solved. You have a question.
Did you see anyone get whipped in the camp?
Did what?
Did you see anyone get whipped in the camp?
Oh, yes, it's a very nice question. There was a tremendous, ugly punishment if you did something wrong. And because they have the power, the sanctioning, to do whatever they want, they gave you 25 hits. There's a baseball bat on the back, right here. And I can tell you, after 25, you don't walk that easily. And your uniform is not blue striped anymore. It is red and white and blue striped. And that is the punishment that you were talking about, the whipping. I saw whipping was one thing, the ultimate was what? In front of all the prisoners were standing and they hanged them. That were the people that were trying to escape. And if they caught them, they were hanged. It is not a nice story, and I don't tell you that, but I tell you for one reason. Power is only because of sanction. Because if it's sanctioned, it's okay. And that's why Hitler had it so easy. He told the people, Jews are not good, Gypsies are not good, Christian ministers are not good, just kill them. And they did.
How did you survive?
Somebody asked me that in the hallway. One of your teachers. It's very hard to really to put it. How did I do it? In percentages, do you know what that means in percentages? I say the following. It is 90% luck. Oh yes. And only 10% strength, your mind is in the right place. And I learned something in prison. When I was in prison all these years ago before, the way I started to tell you, in the city of Utrecht, I told myself, I am not going to give Hitler the pleasure to kill me. And luck was with me, 90%. And because it was good in my mind, I wanted to be an advertising man, and I became an advertising man. And I survived the war. That is really the way I survived. 90% luck. Are you going to say something? Oh, your face was like you were thinking.
I'm in shock, I'm just dumbfounded.
Thank you.
Any
Did you see provisions? What you mad at Nazis?
Anybody that really can shed change in the
film? Yes, I can.
Yeah?
So, were you mad at the Nazis? Did you want to
seek revenge? Okay, that's a very good, excellent question. I'm so glad you mentioned that. So after the war, there was one person that I was ready to kill. But I was sick. I had to stay in bed for a year to fill that hole in my lung, big as an American quarter, with the medicine paraminosalicyl, and the Juve year. And I have that name in my mind. I will not mention his name. I'm going to get him, and I'm fine. So after the war, I was looking for him. And wherever he had a job, I went there. And went into the room of the president, if I had a chance. I said, see that number? This guy downstairs got me there. And then I tell him how he did it. That he knew that it was Jan Groen and not Cornelius Rosenbrock. And I did that for a number of years. And my father got me in his office. And he said, Jaap, sit down. You are on the wrong way to restore your life. Your hatred is so strong that it's all you can think about and all you want to do. Give it up. And I tried and I tried. And one day I was standing in a store with a friend of mine. And I was standing behind the counter. And I was back to 110, 120 pounds. And I looked through the glass door, and there he walked by. I jumped over the counter, ran outside, grabbed him by his neck, turned him around, and ripped his mouth open. He had a scar this big. Terrible! Right? If you do that now, you go to prison. So, police came all the way around, people around. And the two of us had to go in the car and to the police station, very close. And we were sitting and waiting, and we didn't talk. And he was bleeding. So finally we were called in, we sit down. And he said to the other guy, let him call him Hank. And he said to Hank, what about your friend here? And he's not my friend, he's my enemy. And the meeting said, why are you his enemy? He said, he sent me there. So he said, come to me in the little office and we talked. He said, go home, forget about him. And what they did to him, I don't know. They didn't kill him. And I don't think they sent him back to prison. And I said, back to prison. After the war in Holland, they found everybody that turned into a Nazi. And he was one of them. He was a couple of years. While I was looking for him, he was in prison. So you see, hatred, don't hate. Hatred is the worst word at what this real story is all about. People start hating because Hitler told them, start hating the Jews and hating the Catholics and all the Christian ministers and all the Egyptians. Don't hate, build. Thank you. Before I go, I'm going to hear the word one more time.
Freedom!
You got it.